After the initial analysis of the existence leaves us with more questions than answers. It is very puzzling. You can see that it is non-trivial to study the whole, to study all that is. If you use more words to describe it, it simply adds to the ignorance of what is. And so, most of the words that are used to describe the existence are negative. We call it the unknowable, we call it the nothing, we call it the emptiness. Not here, not in time, not an object, an illusion, and so on. It is not that it is something which is non-existent. We are using the so-called language of ignorance to describe that which is right here, right now. The language of ignorance is built around illusory objects which are useful for survival, which help in keeping this organism alive. For example, the shapes, the colors, the smells, the causes, the effects, the purposes, the intentions, and that which is does not yield to this language of ignorance. And so all that we can do is wipe out the concepts and ideas that we wrongly apply to the existence. So time is very useful for survival, the day and night and all the cycles, to arrange the meetings and all. But it is completely inapplicable to what is, to this existence. That which is an illusion cannot explain that which exists. And that is why we come up with all this negative language. Why do we call it empty? Why is it all emptiness? Because out of these two components of the existence, the experience and the experiencer cannot be seen. It is as good as not being there. And the experience, as we saw, is of objects, is of things that are dependently existent. Just like the waves, they dependently exist, cannot be seen independently of the water in which they are appearing. So the whole of our experience is like this. We are going to talk about the experience in more detail, and we are going to talk about the experiencer also in more detail. We are going to very thoroughly analyze both of these, but right now it must be your direct experience that this is so. And so nothing remains in the existence. If both of these faces are void, we have no choice but to use a word like emptiness to describe it. That is what we see. It is not that we do not see anything. It is not that we do not understand anything at all. We do. Otherwise, there was no point of path of knowledge. What we see is emptiness. Is it really empty? Like an empty bowl or like an empty space? No, it is full of experience. It is choke full of the experiencer. There is not even the tiniest bit in existence where there is nothing. Nothingness is impossible. So it is a little bit paradoxical that we need to call it empty, while again seeing that there is a lot going on in this emptiness. So what is it empty of? That is a good question. It does not have all that which you assumed. Very simply, there is no substance. There is nothing outside it. There are no causes. There is no time. There is no place. There are no objects and there are no people. There is no I also. And whatever is seen here is existing dependently. Nothing has an independent existence. So it is empty of all that which we assumed exists. Anyhow, that is my interpretation. Since it is empty, there remains nothing to know. And therefore, we call it unknowable. But you can say that, no, I know so many things. I can see all the objects. You call them illusion, but they are real for me. I see myself here, sitting here, listening. This is a real experience for me. And I know what it is. This is existence. And just like we saw, it appears real because you do not have proper means of knowledge. You do not have proper criteria to distinguish what is true, what is not. If you had, it will all fall apart. The reality will shatter like a glass. Or it will be seen like a dream, like there was nothing and I assumed it to be everything. We have already seen in the past episodes that knowledge is itself ignorance. What we think we know is actually ignorance. When this knowledge is wiped out or is purified, we may call it knowing, but that is confusing. So we call it unknowing. we proceed towards the unknowable by unknowing. This is very strange. But why can't I know? You see, the human mind does not really give up. So yes, we can know all that is illusory can be known. There is no problem in that. But all that is empty. There is nothing to know here. Oh no, I am here, I am sitting here, I am the experiencer. That is also empty. And that is all you can know. So it is not unknowable because we are unable to know it, because we lack the intelligence and resources to know it. It is unknowable because there is nothing to know there. It is empty. Again, that is my interpretation. Because we are doing the advanced analysis, you will find that it now diverges a lot. There will be many, many opinions. There are so many scholars and very bright people, and they have opined differently. But the basics, everybody agrees on the basics. So there can be opinions like, well, we are too tiny to know. One day we'll advance enough and then the unknowable will become knowable. And there are others who say, well, it will always remain unknowable. This tiny thing is tiny for a reason. It is limited. The instrument of the mind is limited. So there can be differences of opinions, but the whole debate does not lead to knowledge. That is my observation. Holding opinions is just adds the noise to the pure silence that is this existence. Now the existential question is that, who am I and what is my relation to this whole? Am I an illusory part of this emptiness? Illusory and empty at the same time, which sounds very, very depressing. And what am I doing here if I am like this? So there is a good news and there is a bad news for this thing that you call I. And the bad news first is that it does not exist. It is also an idea and concept. We never see the thing called I. This is a survival mechanism that evolved to support the organism. That is all. So what is the relation? The same relation which other objects have with other, which other processes and other appearances have with the existence. And that is, they constitute the existence. Remember, the illusion is also part of the whole. The existence contains both true and false. Our job is to see the truth, drop the false, not to worry about the relations and what will happen to me. There is no you, so nothing can happen to you. This is the good news. You can assign this I to the whole existence if you want. We are going to do that in coming episodes. Specifically, it feels very satisfying if we assign the I to the experiencer, that which is experiencing these illusions. We may like to call it I, because obviously I cannot be an illusion. I cannot be the false one. So I will be the true one. And that settles this question and this fear. And as you can see, it is completely arbitrary and made up. There are no rules about what should be the position of the I regarding the existence. You can keep it anywhere. Make the I that which makes you happy, which makes this organism happy. Now, this seems like a big burden to exist here and to do this donkey work of survival. Mother Nature is always throwing bricks at me. Not even one day goes without struggle. What is the use of this life if it is totally illusion, if it is totally emptiness? Isn't it better that I kill myself and I don't exist at all? It will be very, very peaceful, given that there are no purposes here. There is no reason to exist here. We saw that all that we think is my purpose is either indoctrination, conditioning, or just imaginary assumptions. So how can I get freedom from this miserable life, pointless existence? And you must have noticed, when people hear about this emptiness and lack of purpose and reason and all those negative statements about the existence, and then the biggest blow is that, no, there is no you also, they will fall into this kind of thinking pattern. And so in the ancient times, this knowledge was given only after a good preparation. The seeker was prepared for this mind-blowing event of knowing the existence, or unknowing, probably. So we are doing it here without any preparation. And so let me tell you that it is pointless to think that it will be better if I don't exist. Because just like I said right now, you already don't exist. The thinking that I exist is just ignorance. Those who are interested can go and watch the video on the transmission series on the illusion of the individual. There is no individual. Or you can wait till we reach that point in this series and then I'll explain it again. So it is pointless to think like this because that which does not exist is thinking. And if you're worried about the freedom, well, because it is not there, it is already free. There is freedom here. And those who are interested can go and take a look at another video in the series of transmissions, which is titled The Illusion of Bondage. As this existence, you are infinitely free. And as this existence, you are eternally existing. The thing that you think will die and can be killed is just an illusion. It is the body, an object. There is no truth in that. So this kind of question can arise out of ignorance, out of not meditating sincerely on the subject of existence. When you have seen that all that appears is illusion dependently existing, that means this body is also like that. And there is now no point in calling this body as I. Because the I appears as a thought, it is an association with this body, identification with this illusory structure. And once that is seen, once that is understood, which should take only 5 minutes actually, then such questions will not arise. So if you recall, I told you there are wrong questions on the path of knowledge. These two questions, they fall in the category of the wrong questions. It is a wrong question because you have not understood the illusion of the I and now you're cooking up a fantasy around this I. So we are going to explore this topic in more detail. I'm going to show you very conclusively that the I is simply an illusion. It is not. And that which is has nothing to do with I or you or anything. It simply is. So this language of ignorance causes a lot of problems. It is very, very effective in survival. But it totally fails when it comes to philosophical matters, truths, existence. And the advanced analysis like this, you will find that I struggle to find the right word and I struggle to convey the ideas without sounding very funny. I can build up a language which is suitable for philosophical topics, but most probably nobody will understand me. And I'm pretty sure wise men in the past must have attempted this. What is the result? The ordinary people or even the seekers, even the most intelligent people, they misunderstood all of it. It was a disaster. So right now we do not have any other means to explain it except I can encourage you to again and again look at your direct experience and again use this very valuable instrument of the mind. And again, I should repeat it. There is nothing to know. Just drop what you already know. Just drop your blind beliefs. And the thoughts like this, I should kill myself, I'm bound and all. These are all rubbish thoughts because they're arising out of ignorance. Clearing the ignorance will clear the garbage. Now this organism can survive happily without the burden of ignorance. There can be more questions like, if it is empty, if there is nothing substantial there, how is it even possible to generate an illusion? Please see that I'm not saying how is it possible to generate the reality. I'm saying how is it even possible to generate the illusion because an illusion also needs something to generate it. Complete emptiness, a complete nothingness cannot generate the illusion. Also, for example, the movie is an illusion, but there is a film behind it. There is a light source behind it. There is a projector behind it. There cannot be a movie without all of these. The illusion does not generate itself. This is the point. So honestly, I do not know the answer to this question. We do not see anything, just like we found in the last episode. There are no processes behind the existence. There is no machinery generating the illusions. What we find is something really strange, that all these illusions are changing. There is no static illusion. Like we noted, there is impermanence. So the change is more fundamental than the illusions. than what appears. And so some scholars have focused their attention on the change. And you must have noticed the criteria for the truth are based on the change. That which is changing is false. That which is changing is appearance. Just like the waves on the surface of the water, it is just change. All there is to the waves is just change. It is not another thing that is being produced. The water is changing. That's all is a wave. So you throw away this concept of wave. You throw away the concept of water, and all that remains is change. Now, how can you describe change? And I've seen that the best way to describe change is as a potential, as a possibility. We cannot say that the change exists. This statement is meaningless. The change exists as what? If nothing is changing, then can the change exist? So we are forced to say that the change does not exist, only a potential exists. This potential appears as change. You know the rest of the story, how the change is converted into information, and the information is then relayed through the senses and the world appears. Or anything appears like this, actually. It is just a computational process. The illusion is computed out of this meaningful change. So at the bottom of everything is a potential or a possibility, also called a probability. Some people may want to call it a field of probability. They may want to extend it in time and space, which is okay. It's not a big issue, because as long as you know that there is nothing there, even the time and space comes out of the potential, then it is okay. It's fine. It is just a tool, thinking tool, a mathematical tool, a logical tool. The error will be to assume that the potential is real or the field of probabilities is real. There is no truth in that. When I say unknowable, it is really unknowable. Only these explanations, they are stand-ins to satisfy a curious mind. And it is amazing what can be done with these kind of assumptions. That emptiness has this potential to appear. Is devoid of anything, but there is a potential. It can cause illusions. It cannot cause anything real. So as you can see, this is the language of ignorance. It is not really causing the illusions. The illusions are appearing to itself. And that is because there is a potential. The potential manifests as change. There is a possibility of a change happening. And that change gives rise to all kinds of illusions. So do not worry if you don't understand why this is so, or why this is helpful to understand the illusions. We are going to go into the depths of it. In the coming episodes, I am going to give you a full analysis of what is potential, what is change, and how illusion is formed out of change. But at its root, it is existence itself, and so it will remain unknowable. Our intellect goes up to the change, or even up to the potential or the field of probabilities. And we stop here by saying that the emptiness is full of potentials. Another question is that, can there be an existence without the experiencer? Is it really necessary to experience it? Actually, I've seen there are some people who actually assume that the existence is independent of the experiencer. It will exist even if nobody is experiencing it. It will exist even if it is not being experienced. Now, let us take a look at this question. Existence is. So, there is no question of can there be. We saw that there cannot be nothingness. So it will be there. However, there will be no knowledge of it. Nothing will appear there. In absence of the experiencer, even the illusion is absent. This we can say logically, because obviously nobody has seen it directly. We always find an experiencer there. So the answer boils down to that it will be unknowable as usual. Without the experiencer, the unknowable will remain unknowable. Even the ignorance cannot be formed. How does the ignorance appear? Because of the experiencer, the illusion is seen, and the illusion makes impressions in the memory, and relations are formed among these illusions. And we say that I know something, which is complete garbage. And then we trace our path backwards to remove all this ignorance. And the experiencer still remains without ignorance. The illusion still remains. The knowledge also still remains. You say it is very good for survival. Don't throw away everything. Only realize that it is not what I think it is. And as we saw in the part one, that actually there is no experiencer already. It is just experiencing, which is not a verb. It is presence, witnessing presence. So the question of leaving out the experiencer comes only when you assume that it can exist apart from the existence. There is no such thing. Experiencer is another name for the existence, that's all. And we are going to do more analysis on the experiencer in next episode and coming episodes. So there is an impossibility here that, let us say, you are pointing at one object and giving it two names, and then you say that, can this object exist without the other name? For example, there is a round object in front of you and you give it two names. You call it a football and you call it a tennis ball. There are two names of the same round object. And then you question, can this round thing exist without the tennis ball? And you can see now it is kind of meaningless. Yes, it can exist without this name removed because it is the round thing. It does not matter what you call it. And then you can also ask, can this round object exist without the football? And it is again meaningless. Similarly, it is meaningless to say that the existence can exist without the experiencer, or the existence can exist without the experience also, which is without the illusions also. Absolutely meaningless. We do break it down into two, and that you can call it as our ignorance, or you can call it as convenience. It becomes convenient if we break down the thing in front of us, study it separately. So this question can arise when there is absolute ignorance about what existence is. What do these words mean? The person who has asked this question has no clue about the meaning of these words. The round object, if not known, people can ask about the football and tennis ball. When it is known, then there are no questions. On the path of knowledge, you must have seen that the questions are dropped automatically when the knowledge arrives. You don't gain a new experience, or no new relations are formed. The old ones are refined. So people have gone forward. They have taken a few steps into the existence for the sole purpose of understanding. There is a desperation to understand what it is among philosophers. So they have broken down it into two. That is why we have the dualist philosophies. And there is an acknowledgement that there is an existence, but there is something more, an add-on to the existence, which is also called the energy of the existence. The existence does nothing without this energy. And the energy causes the illusions, the forms to appear. The energy is the cause here. So the why question got answered like this. What is energy really? What is this concept of energy? Whenever there is a change, big or small, we assume that there is an agency behind it which caused that change. The change cannot happen by itself. This is a general notion. It needs a cause. This is some requirement in our minds. We cannot actually visualize a change without there being a cause or energy behind it. So the energy boils down to change. Big change means big energy. A small change means there is small energy behind it. You can even quantify this thing. How much change is there and how much energy is there. So this is how the concept of energy appeared in the dualistic philosophies, because they could not accept that there can be illusion without any other agency, without a cause of it. So this energy was then borrowed by physical sciences, and it is a very useful concept. I am not saying that it's kind of foolish. What is foolish is believing that this concept is reality. So yes, energy itself is an illusion. There is no energy. There is only change. We assume that it is being caused by the agency of energy. The word energy is very interesting. It has the urge in it, means will. And it has the en as prefix, means internal. So I don't really know who came up with this word, but it shows that there was an assumption that things have an internal will to move or change. It is not completely wrong, you see. It's very poetic, but it's not wrong. But is there something like this? And the obvious answer is no. We do not see it except as a concept. It is an assumption. It works in certain cases. When you are not after truth, when you are just trying to explain it away, then it works. And energy boils down to change. So the question remains, what is causing the change? I mean, if the energy is not a thing, It is not real. And what is there? And as we saw, there is potential. Now, it is another explanation. So, I do not invest too much in this potential thing also. But makes our life very easy. And you will see in coming episodes when I explain the mechanisms in much more detail, this potential field of probabilities or even energy is going to be very useful. It is kind of soothing for a human mind to know answers. But we will be in a domain of illusions completely. In existence, no energy, no potential, no change, nothing. So now a few notes on the historical or ancient terminology used by the very, very wise people and great philosophers. And many of you must have noticed a lot of similarities of whatever I've said so far with traditions. So, for example, I've taken the words emptiness and form, and all those words were taken straight up from Buddhism. And the words like non-dual and experiencer, etc., they are taken from Advaita, non-dualism. This word existence, it corresponds to Brahman in Advaita. So there you can link a little bit. The concept of there being an energy corresponds to the Shakti in Shaivism. There nobody calls it illusion. It is the cause of illusion. There are more dualistic philosophies where this energy will be named differently. For example, in the Sankhya, it will be the Prakriti, and the existence itself is the Purush. So there you can join some dots with the historical knowledge of existence and other things in it. So it should be noted that on the path of knowledge, we try to use the concepts, but we drop them as soon as possible. So let us drop the concepts, and I would suggest that you do not simply accept what was said here. Be critical of it, be skeptical of it, but be open-minded. Give it a chance, and it should become your knowledge. It should destroy your ignorance. It should not become another philosophy stuffed in another corner of your mind. In your free time, meditate on this. Meditate on the existence.